Thank you. A pleasure to be here. So what's the plan for today? Alright, so I'm talking about combinatorial subvarieties of flag varieties. I'll be giving three different lectures, and I'm hoping to talk about three different families of varieties, right? So the first one is going to be Schubert varieties, the second one is going to be Springer fibers, the third one will be Hessenberg varieties. But actually, what I'm going to do today, starting with Schubert varieties, is really, really I'm just going to actually anti-flag varieties, and I'll be thinking about geometry, algebra, and combinatorics. So I know there's like a wide range of different experiences with Lie theory in the audience. And so some of the things that I will be talking about are definitely things that if you've got like formal classroom exposure to Lie theory, you have like kind of thought about this. I think sometimes from a slightly different perspective, unless you're a student of Alan Knutson's, in which case you like know everything that I'm going to say today. Superior advisor in education. So I'm basically going to start from scratch and build up. So then I will go more specifically into Schubert varieties. And like on one hand, I'm going to be talking about their geometry. But on the other hand, it's kind of like just like inextricably tied to their combinatorics. So that's where we're going today. All right. So let's just start with flag varieties. Okay. And our first working definition of a flag variety. What a flag is it's a line contained in a plane contained in n minus one dimensional space contained in some fixed n-dimensional complex vector space. So each VI is an i-dimensional vector space, right? So the flag variety is all of those things. So that is just where we are going to start. So for instance, here's a picture, right? So like, the origin, which is contained in everything, because all of these pieces are vector spaces, and then I could pick a line, like whoop, that's a little bit wobbly, but it is supposed to be a line, and then I could pick some plane that goes through the line, and it's sitting inside the three-dimensional space. So this is like some example of a flag. You can see it actually looks like a flag, so that's what your flag variety is, like that. So second example. So the second example, this is going to be all flags in C2, because not to like ruin the suspense or anything, but basically my goal for this whole first piece exploring the flag variety is to describe all possible flags from multiple different perspectives. So let's just start with thinking about all flags in C2. It's kind of hard for me to draw a complex plane, so I'm just going to draw a real plane, and we'll just like imagine that you know what I'm thinking about. So here's my real plane. Here's my fixed origin. So what do I get to do? All flags in C2 is actually, since C2 is fixed and the origin is fixed, I'm really just picking any possible line through the origin, right? On one hand, all flags in C2 is like just lines through the origin. But what I'd like to do is also just like kind of observe for a second. If we want to describe all of them, if we want to describe all of these flags, we could do something like say the following. Right. So what I kind of want to do is start, say, with some particular line. So here's my favorite line, I'm gonna call this my favorite line because it is spanned by one of the coordinate vectors.
Can you use a different color?
Yeah. How's this color? Better? Alright. Also, if I get too quiet, you can also, especially people in the back, do the same thing. Alright, so here's this one particular line. And so the thing that I kind of want to notice here is like, it is good enough. If I want to keep track of all flags in C2, it's basically good enough to keep track of where you are on the unit circle over here, except that somehow when you get over here, you like go back to the beginning. Right? So there's this like kind of, yeah, right? Put it back with all the others. Something else will find. So that's sort of this picture where you kind of like, you could just keep track of this as this one point instead of keeping all this information of the line. Just pick one point that's not on the origin. You've got all of your information about your line, but in that case, then you kind of need to remember the points glue together a little bit differently than they would in actual real life. So having said that, let's draw a big picture. So let's draw all flags. In C3. And so now I actually need to do something a little bit more complicated than just like turning complex numbers into real numbers. So that I can do. That I can do, and I'll cut down some dimensions. But I'm also going to, I'm also going to sort of like decompactify. So what I'm also going to do is instead of keeping track of the line, I'm going to think about the line as a point plus the origin. I'm going to think about my plane as just a line. And I'm basically just going to draw, I am just going to draw something like, here's a plane sitting in, and then C3 is going to actually just become the chalkboard. And so I am just like belaboring this to remind us that like, if we take this point, which is actually a line, and we make it head off to the right there on this line, which is actually a plane, eventually it's going to like, just zip around and come in on the other side. Just as if you take that black dot right over there and start it on the green line and then start moving it along that semicircle, it will eventually hit the other green line and be back to itself again. Okay. All right, so then let's draw all of the flags. So I'm going to start, this will just be my flag that is coordinate axes, because that's a nice flag. So I've got one particular line inside one particular plane inside of all of C3. And what I'd like to do now is imagine how to change that situation, right? Like, what's a way to go from this particular kind of flag to some slightly other kinds of flags? I think I'm gonna go look at that example right over there and say, you know, I could just like move the line inside the plane. That will give me some other collection of flags. All right, so what does that look like? Well, that looks like, here's my original flag, so we can just like reference it. We've got some like base point there. All right, so this right here. And I'm going to try not to do this too badly. Let me even just take a vote. I can refer to this as moving a line in the plane, or I can refer to this as moving the dot on the line. And each of them is going to confuse somebody in the room. So I'm just gonna try not to alternate between the two, because that would be like the worst. So can I just like have a quick show of hands? Would you rather this be moving the line in the plane or moving the dot on the line? All right, so everybody just raise your hands. If you don't care, just raise your hands and anyone, right? Like arbitrary. Who wants us to be lying in the plane? Never mind.
Can we put scare quotes on the line?
All right. So there's one thing I can do. I can move a line in a plane. What's some other small change I can make? Perturbing this base flag that gives me a family of flags.
Move the plane.
I can move the plane. All right, so I can move the plane in the three space. All right, what's that gonna look like? Well, now the line and the dot are gonna stay completely the same. I'm going to shift C3 a little bit. Okay, do I have all possible flags? Maybe not. Maybe. One approach that we try here is like we have these two like operations, moving a line in the plane, moving a plane in C3. We could just try like repeating those operations and see if we get anything new. All right, so like if I move the line in the plane and then I move the line in the plane a little bit more, I actually am just getting one of the flags that this picture represents, so I don't get any new information there. On the other hand, if I move the line in the plane and then move the plane in the line, then I get something like, flags than either this or this or this, because that sort of set of relationships and intersections is just different. So let's go over here and let's try doing the same thing. Let's see. So now moving a plane anymore is just going to get me another one of these same in this same family. But I could do something like that. Move the line a little bit and get something else. Is this everything? Who knows? Let's try some more and see what happens. So I'll go back over here and try moving the line slightly from this picture. Whereas if I come over here and I try moving the plane, I could slide, just sort of like rotate that purple line and get to exactly this configuration over here. So I'm actually kind of getting the same family of flags. So on one hand, I'm like, okay, great, like we did it, we found all of the flags. On the other hand, I wouldn't feel bad at all. I mean, you wouldn't hurt my feelings if you're like, that is like incredibly unconvincing. Like, this is an interesting way of sort of keeping track of flags inside the flag variety. In fact, it does actually describe them all. And for certain kinds of people who are very geometrically inclined, it's a really nice way of thinking about them. It also this is foreshadowing, not actually a spoiler. But it also gives you some sense of how to move around inside the flag variety. So what limits look like and what closures look like. On the other hand, it's like super, super unrigorous. And thus, I would like to give you a different description also, and then maybe match it up to this one. So let's try a description to you. All right. So let's try describing flags algebraically. And like I said, when we go back and pull this one, this description up for us again. Okay, so not to go all algebra on you, but that's actually what I'm going to do. So this is a line, thus it is spanned by a single vector. All right. So let's say it is spanned by this vector g1. Then this is a plane containing v1. Same thing, right? We can think of this as span. We can take two vectors that span the plane, and we can keep doing this, and pick a collection of vectors, one after another, each of which forms the new dimensional piece of my flag. And what does that give us at the end of the day? So the matrix. All right, so this matrix with column vectors g1, g2, gn. Represents that particular flag. So that's one thing that I can do. So the thing is, that's really redundant, right? So like, I have a lot of different choices of which vector spans a line. Like, I have a whole non-zero scalar multiples worth of choices about which vector spans a line. I have a whole bunch of choices for g2 also, right? I could take any non-zero scalar multiple of g2 and then add any multiple of g1 and get the same plane, and so on and so forth. Okay, so. So actually, what I am just saying there is that if you take any upper triangular invertible matrix, GB gives the same flag. Maybe this isn't worth noticing, but maybe it is worth noticing. This matrix here also has to be invertible, right? Because its columns span all of Cn. Okay. So having noticed that, so this is a vice versa statement. I'm going to call E the upper triangular invertible matrices. What we are kind of more or less claiming is that the flag variety is this quotient of n by n invertible matrices by upper triangular matrices. Okay, so I say most people in this sort of context, in this sort of, if you're at this conference and you think about flag varieties, there's a pretty good chance you actually just saw flag varieties defined that way. So I would like to match this up with this picture over here. And to do that, here's kind of what I want to do. I would like to let's pick a good representative. Right? I mean, we have a lot of choices. There are a lot of matrices that are describing the same flag, and I'd like to pick one. Again, and like, I'm just going to like evoke your first linear algebra lecture, basically, and say, well, we have to take our matrix and like normalize it in some sort of useful way, And you already know about the methods to do that, and they're called things like Gaussian elimination or column reduction or something like that. So like that's just what we need. So if I take this good representative, there are different conventions, but what I'm gonna do is so I'm gonna like rescale column so the list non-zero entry is one. And then use that column to eliminate all non-zero entries to the right of that one. Useful to have an actual word to refer to that one, which many people do have in linear algebra, but it turns out a lot of people don't. So that is your pivot on that thing and eliminate all of the other entries. So what are some of the examples of what that would kind of look like? Well, so for instance, so another way of saying that is, right, you have like So for instance, if you take those coordinate axes, those are standard basis vectors, and put those one in each column, you can see this is also like perfectly good representative for the coset according to these rules. If you were to flip just a little bit, you'd say the first pivot. The pivot in the first column is in the second entry, then you kind of be allowed to have anything you wanted in the entry right above that pivot. And some other entries. So just because I saw an expression in the crowd, so I just look at this one for a moment and say, like, so what this first column is telling us is that the line is spanned by so the line is always zero in the third coordinate, and then it's spanned by a vector of this form. The good representative that we're going to take is just one in which we have normalized that lowest number of 3 to 1. So eliminate it. Keep going in that way. So, all right. So I'd like to. I'd like to go through here and see what happens if we try to attach these flags to matrices that have been normalized kind of in this particular way. Okay, so over here we said we were just taking coordinate vectors. That's a perfectly good thing. Okay, now what we want to do is we want to move the line inside the plane. Actually, this is kind of like actually that first example that we were thinking about. We're just going to like attach all the way to it now. So the plane is always the span of the first two vectors, since we are hopefully listing all of the flags uniquely, exactly once, we want to like eliminate, like disregard the one where we just have a one in the first entry. So moving the line in the plane gives us something like something in the second entry. Right, so you have to be in the span of the first two vectors. The line is in the span of the first two vectors here of E1, E2, and it is not E1 itself. So the family of other options are E2 plus some multiple of E1. Those are the other options that are in the span of E1 and E2. And then because the plane still is staying fixed, the plane still has to be span of E1 and E2, and that's what this is. Just so, if we want to move the plane in C3, we're really doing the same thing, but shifting the second two columns. Same picture, but we also just ignored the first entry by some sort of quotient operation. Okay, so now we're going to be a little bit more fancy here for a second. So if I want to move the plane inside the free space for any flag of this form. Okay, so the first thing I can say is, since I'm moving the plane inside the free space, the line is staying the same, so the line is just like this. Right? And now if I'm moving the plane in the three space, you're gonna have a similar kind of argument, right? Like we've got two different basis vectors that we're thinking of some sort of linear combination of E1 and E3, and I'm throwing out E1, so I'm left with like E3 plus some multiple of E1. And because I have those pivots, I know there's only one way to fill things in. Right, I'm going to do the same thing over here, but we are moving a line inside the plane. So we get something like this. And why don't I move from here over? So I'm going to move this plane inside of the three space, which is going to switch these E1 and E2 around and leave me with something like this. Okay, now we can actually maybe like convince ourselves a little bit more that if I move this line inside of this plane, I will end up kind of sort of flipping these columns in some way and adding this new free entry and getting flags of exactly the same form as if I went around the other leg. So what are the nice things? What are the nice things to observe about this? Well, so first off, I think it's actually like far more compelling from the matrix point of view to say that we have actually listed all possible flags, and we have listed them exactly once. Like, we have not like doubled up any in those pictures. And that's like partly just because you can start thinking to yourself, if I do some sort of normalization, some sort of like Gaussian elimination type thing with matrices, I mean, like, I'm gonna have to have pivots somewhere, and they're gonna have to all be in separate different entries from each other. So there's gonna be some sort of permutation. If I'm only allowed to Gaussian eliminate in certain particular ways, as represented by that sort of upper triangular B, then I'm going to have free entries somewhere, right? So you can sort of start arguing out to yourself, this is exactly my options, and the bijective list of options. But I also said that I've got some combinatorics associated to this stuff, the combinatorics is right there. We have like these permutation matrices sitting on the board. So there are my permutation matrices. Let's say this for now. Okay, so inside. There's permutation matrices inside each of these cells, just by setting the free entries to zero. Okay, I think time will probably permit. So I'm going to like describe a couple different ways of describing permutation. With one line notation, what I'm going to do is record the row of the pivot in column I in position I. and the next pivot is in row three, so next entry is a three, and the third pivot is in row one, so the first entry is one. So here are my okay, so there are permutations. Just like naturally sitting inside here, there is linear algebra stuff and this geometry picture. Let me tell you about cheaper price. One state. These are partitioned into cells. So the cells CW are indexed by permutations. And they form a CW decomposition. Which we'll say a couple more words about in a few minutes, but like it's a very nice topological decomposition. Here's one piece. So these cells are indexed by permutations. The cells are often called Schubert cells. They form a CW decomposition. I'm going to keep this on the board. Come over here. And also, sort of for completeness, say that Schubert varieties. The Schubert variety. Closure of the Schubert cell associated W and there's nothing particularly special about using the Flight variety. A bunch of the exercises talk about how you can do a very similar decomposition for Grassmannians as well. And I'm sort of staying in the type A land, but what I say is also true not in type A. I'd like to talk about geometry of these Schubert varieties and these Schubert cells for a second. So what sorts of properties might I care about? So let's start by caring about dimension for a minute. So what do I mean by dimension? I'm not formally going to define dimension, but since we have these pictures on the board, I'm going to use some kind of dimension, right? So each of these matrices is representing one of these Schubert cells, and on the one hand, the dimension is like the number of free entries that you have. So it's the number of stars in each of those cells. Here's another sort of fuzzy description of dimension, right? The amount of freedom that a moving part in each of the cell has, right? Like, so this yellow dot is like sliding along one dimension. There's this one dimension, but the whole line is sliding. It has like also one dimension of freedom. What angle is it hitting? So there's one dimension. And if you kind of move up And if your mind is oriented in this direction, then it seems very natural to you that there's like two dimensions, 2 degrees of freedom in these pictures, and three degrees of freedom up at the very top. So, all right, so we have this geometric and algebraic thing. So there's like one other thing that I would like to say, which is like maybe a definition. So an inversion in a permutation in one line notation is a place. Is a pair of numbers I, j, I is greater than j with I to the left of j. So for instance, 2, 3, 1. So 3 is greater than 1 and to the left of 1. 2 is greater than 1 and to the left of 1. So an inversion, they don't need to be right next to each other. But that's another interesting combinatorial thing called a descent, but not useful here. And then 2 and 3 are in the right order, so this is actually all of the inversions in this permutation. So the dimension of the Schubert cell is the number of inversions of the permutation. And I just want to like double check that over here, at least in a couple instances. We've got 0 inversions over here because everything is going in the right order. We have 3 inversions over here because everybody is in the exact wrong order. 2 inversions because I already computed it. 1 inversion here, and in fact, I've drawn it so that we have the same number of inversions on each level. So it dimensions the number of inversions. Closure of CW. Okay. So I'm going to give you another way of thinking about permutations, which I'm going to put on the board another way of thinking about permutations, which is change I and I plus 1. Okay, my first statement. I'm going to put that up on the board here. This is the identity.